Hi, my name's Bob Grinier, and I'm a volunteer with the Martin Fleischmann Memorial Project. Today I want to talk about a proposal, and it is for the passive deactivation of radionuclides. Now, why am I saying this? Well, there are a lot of potential uses for Lorentz nuclear reactions. Some of those are being developed in the terms of energy generation and also element production. But I want to focus this presentation on something that I think needs to be addressed. There is something facing the planet, which is kind of like boiling frog scenario, where nuclear technology, fission in principle, has caused a number of events like Fukushima and Chernobyl. And these are compounding because they are not going away very, very quickly. And what I would like to do is to have in preparation and to deal with the extinction level event that we are effectively currently facing. So the purpose of this presentation is to put forward a proposal to test variations of linear technology that could avert this possible extinction level event. Now, the Fukushima nuclear disaster and the Enewetak Atoll both, in my opinion, represent an existential threat to our biosphere. And the risk I'm saying here is effectively, as far as human civilization is concerned, it's permanent. Why do I say that? Well, 239 plutonium, which has a half-life of 24,110 years. Well, when we think about Göbekli Tepe, we have a civilization that has been there for, say, 12,000 years. Well, this is twice that before you even get to half the radioactive emissions output from 239 plutonium. So if we have some plutonium in the melted down cores in Fukushima or in the waste dump on Inuitak Atoll from the US nuclear testing in the Pacific, then that plutonium is going to take, you know, 24,000 years to get to half its activity and another 24,000 years to get to quarter of its activity and another 24,000. It's going to be 100,000 years before it's got to sort of like 1/16th of its activity. But the amount of plutonium that is in Fukushima is just unimaginable in terms of its biotoxicity. And really, despite a lot of people's protestations and suggestions and so forth, there really is no known solution to Fukushima and Enewetak Atoll. And they are both highly dependent on there not being a natural phenomena such as typhoons or earthquakes in, 100,000 years, which is kind of like, let's say, eight times since the civilization that built Göbekli Tepe. So now, if you can't even maintain a civilization for a few hundred to a few thousand years, what on earth is the likelihood that for 100,000 years we're going to be able to deal respectfully and have the economics to deal with respectfully Fukushima and Enewetak Atoll? We have to ask ourselves, what are we handing to the next generation? So what I would like to do is to leverage the emerging understanding of the nature of the active agent in low-energy nuclear reactions. And it is proposed that attempts are made to develop both active and passive means of neutralizing the problems at these and other sites. This presentation is to focus on offset passive methods, which could serve as a toolset to manage nuclear accidents and waste in the future. Okay, so what do I mean by offset passive methods? Well, essentially they're passive in that they're not powered by electricity or sun or whatever at the time of their use, but you may need to use an active method to produce the material. This slide here I produced more than 1 year ago. It was part of the O-Day presentation, and all I've done is I've added a couple of extra details in here, but all of the graphics is exactly as it was over 1 year ago. And really, the kind of thing that I was thinking and that dawned on me at the beginning of last year was there is really only one way that I can see that works within accepted science, let's say, that the transmutation of material can happen such that you don't get this output, and it must be due to some neutrino interactions with the radioactive or non-radioactive material. And so I gave this here, I put this into the chart as an example, where you have tritium, and it goes to 3 helium with the emission of a beta particle from one of the neutrons and an antineutrino. And the idea that I had was that the active agent was somehow capturing neutrinos and antineutrinos, manipulating the matter within it. Now, at the time, I did not know about the idea of fast neutrinos and cold neutrinos. I thought they were all the same thing, so I thought this could be basically getting neutrinos from anywhere. However, long before I became involved in LENA, I saw this article in New Scientist from the 14th of May 2003. And what it's suggesting is that neutrino beam could neutralize nuclear bombs. And essentially, there was some Japanese scientists, and they were suggesting that if we made a neutrino generator and we could fire the beam that it produced straight through the Earth to a known nuclear weapon, and it would essentially disable it. And these scientists here at Oxford University say, yep, the maths and the physics seems to be right and could be technically feasible, but it would need massive investment. And essentially what they're saying is that the neutrinos go through and they affect the plutonium and uranium that you have typically in a nuclear bomb. Even hydrogen bombs will have a plutonium or plutonium and uranium trigger, even if they've got something like lithium deuteride or something in there to produce tritium and so forth. So they will always have these elements in there. And essentially, they're saying that it could even be produced within 10 or 20 years, and this is in 2003. The energy is ridiculous. The scale is 1,000 kilometers wide. But anyway, I had this always in the back of my mind that neutrinos could basically stabilize radioactive material and that the science is correct. And so this was something that kind of dawned on me at the beginning of last year. What if we could capture neutrinos? Now, I had had the pleasure of visiting Alexander Parkhomov with the support of the supporters of the MFMP project. And on the 27th of the 2nd, 2015, Alexander showed me this device, which he had been running in his home lab for about two decades. So here we have a chart. And on the chart, it goes back to something like 1997 or something. And he has looked at, here, 239 plutonium. And this was done in the early 2000s. We have cobalt 60 and we have strontium 90. And what he showed is that with the cycle of the summer and winter, there was basically a change based on the location of the Earth in respect of the sun. The suggestion is that the gravity of the sun is effectively lensing the cosmogenic neutrinos. Now, I did not know at this time when he showed me this on the 27th of February 2015. I did not know that the cosmogenic neutrinos were any different from the normal neutrinos. So I have to confess that when I had this insight at that point, I thought it was just neutrinos were neutrinos and the active agent was capturing them. Now, from the work of Alexander Shishkin, he's suggesting in October 2018 that strange radiation actually, or at least variations of it, are comprised of a large number of neutrinos. Not necessarily exclusively, but they contained neutrinos within them. And these neutrinos interact with matter. So he's basically saying strange radiation appears to enable interaction of matter with neutrinos. And why is that important? Well, as described in Alexander Parkhomov's recent paper using cold neutrino transmutations involving electrons, he's essentially saying that you have neutrinos, but they are of the cold variety. These are the type that he's talking about here, the cosmogenic neutrinos, not the ones from the sun, the 50 billion per centimeter squared per second or something like that, that we get from the sun, but the ones that are cosmogenic. They are able to do a reverse beta process, so it can make a proton into a neutron, a neutron into a proton. And he's also suggesting in here that the production of these neutrinos and antineutrinos are when you have electrons and condensed matter that is over, say, 2000 Kelvin, and the electrons come together and they collide, and that they can actually produce these neutrinos and antineutrinos. Now, potentially, actually, when you have a plasma or you have a cavitation bubble, you have these high temperatures. But it might also be because, as I'll show you later, John Hutchison is able to seemingly create the same effect. It might actually, but just by creating the active agent, that the electrons that form the toroid, as they are collapsing in and condensing themselves, may be colliding with sufficient energy to produce neutrinos that then become part of the structure itself. So it could be almost a self-generating process under certain circumstances. So a growing body of evidence is suggesting that neutrinos are playing a role here. And so whilst I thought I was really not talking with any firm foundation, if I'd have presented this a year ago, I feel much more comfortable. And so this image you see under here, which you can get from this link down here, is Enewetak Atoll. Essentially, the Pacific testing by the US was conducted and the waste was gathered up and it was dumped under this concrete dome, which is very not thick. The tide washes in and out of this, and one typhoon can come along and maybe damage this, and the plutonium and other radionuclides that are in this dome could then just become part of the Pacific. And of course, this is the sort of mapped debris coming from the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster, where you have three molten down cores. And this is so serious that even years later, they make these robots that cost millions and millions, and they go in and they only last for 2 hours because the radiation is so intense it destroys the electronics, even with all the shielding that they have. So they don't even know where the cores are, and at least one of these reactors, and probably all three. You know, as I've said before, this is a problem that's hundreds of thousands of years, potentially, depending on where the cores are. And so as this debris comes out, it would carry material with it, with the trade winds and the flows of water and so on. So really, this is a problem for the whole Pacific, and it's a very large proportion of the area of the planet. So it's really a problem for the whole planet, and particularly for the West Coast in America and South America and Central America and all these high populated areas in Southeast Asia. So the radionuclides here, I'm saying that the radionuclides exposed to devices of Hutchison and Shoulders and others claimed subsequent reduced activity. This was actually sent to me a few days ago by John Hutchison. I've spoken to Steve Colburn in the past about some other tests that he has done, but this test was reported on the 3rd of May 2012. This is significantly after John sold the Hutchison lab that I visited at the beginning of last year in Germany. So this is with equipment that he has and retains, and I believe it's the LifeRay, the basic LifeRay, which he has now made supersize. And Steve Colburn sent him a uranium ore sample from the Uranite from Utah, and it exposed it for 30 days to the LifeRay, and this produced a radioactive count reduction. So formerly it was 75,000 counts per minute, and after the 1 month of exposure, it had gone to 50,000 counts. So it's not half, but it's kind of like one third. So maybe if this had been increased to say 50 days or something or more, you could have got a half. And of course, some of the isotopes of uranium, like 4.5 billion years. John Hutchison described it to me. He said it's like a time acceleration machine, but actually it's kind of affecting the rate of decay by shifting it. So in this, they see that the original sample had no lead, it had no gold and so forth. And these are the elements detected in the control sample. And in the process sample, you have this production of lead here and of gold and of a range of other elements that you can expect to find in some transmutations. So it's interesting that we're seeing lead, and it's also very interesting that we're seeing gold. And he provides some hypothesis for the production of these elements, because obviously lead is the end of decay chain from uranium, and he gives some information here, and you can go and have a look at this in your own time. The link will be in the presentation, as will all the links in the YouTube video description. going back to the presentation, so John Hutchison had done this test. This is done in 2012. It's published in 2012. So the insights that could be almost obvious from understanding that that is real and starting to understand the mechanism cannot be patented. So I think I need to thank John Hutchison for putting that out there in 2012. Then there is the work of Shoulders, and this is David Yurth, and this presentation I made before, but this is about an 11-year study where they created these exotic vacuum objects, these charge clusters, and they shot them into radioactive material, and in one shot, the activity of the sample was reduced by 50%. So we have a couple of examples here. There are other examples. And so the proposal here is to test and develop passive technologies rather than the active technologies at this stage. And the reason I'm saying that is if we could create some material that was basically a lump of stuff, you could just have a robot or some even mechanical device that could go along and take off one of these panels and dump it into this dome and let it do its work. Emit the strange radiation. The strange radiation is going into the radioactive material and it is making it stable. Again, with Fukushima, you go along and you dump this material that you've produced and it passively fixes the problem in situ. We need to fix this problem here and we need to fix this problem here. We can't fix it when it's two-thirds of the surface area of the planet or something and it's in our atmosphere and it's in our food chain. It's just going to be impossible. We need to fix it in situ, and this provides a passive potential method for doing this job. So what is the basis for this study? Well, ECHO in summer of 2017 and LION in September 2017 both showed evidence of transmutation and the production of strange radiation. LION reported in early 2018 that reheating his 9-month-old Cu2O to over 1000 degrees C for 8 hours caused it to expose X-ray film in a way consistent with that of signatures of strange radiation. So essentially he's showing that an old sample from a reactor, when reheated, could be reinvigorated by a simple application of infrared energy. In mid-2018, during a face-to-face meeting between John Hutchison and members of the MFMP, he reported that material treated by his technology passively deactivated other radionuclide samples when in proximity to them. Now, this is quite a funny story, actually, because essentially what he said was this radioactive nuclide supplier, you know, for check sources and other things, sent this sample to be treated to see if the activity would be lowered. And John dutifully obliged and sent back to the sample. Then a couple of months later, this supplier phoned him up and said, "Look, listen, don't send me any more treated material." And John said, "Like, why?" And he says, "Well, all the other samples in my stockroom have lowered their activity." Okay, that might sound like a bit of a problem if you're a supplier of samples for check sources or, you know, other radioactive needs. However, this sounds like a really good thing from my point of view. Essentially, what he's saying is that when we have a material that seems to be transmuted by low-energy nuclear reactions, there seems to be strange radiation that goes along with it. It comes out, and Shishkin and I and it would seem Parkhomov all agree that this does seem to contain some neutrinos somehow within it, and these can, through the weak force, cause neutrons and protons to change. And it would seem that something that is unstable wants to become stable. That is the nature of reality in the world that we live. Unstable things become stable. And John is saying that this kind of accelerates that process. And so this gives a tool by which the strange radiation can do the acceleration. It may not be the only trick in its toolbox, but we have something that's in a material that's been treated that's coming out and it's affecting other material that wasn't treated. And then I talked about this particular experience of LION to two scientists called Zetelepin and Baranov in the 2018 Cold Nuclear Transmutation and Ball Lightning Conference in Sochi. And they had told me that strange radiation can be produced from ballistically impacted bismuth, that's something that they had done on steel. And when I talked about this 9-month-old CuTO being reinvigorated by exposing to 8 hours of 1,000 degrees C heat, they said, well, get this. We took our strange radiation-producing bismuth that had lost its activity, and we took it into sunlight 2 years after it was produced, and it again produced strange radiation. And so the characters I'm talking about are here in this particular video. You will also see a conversation between him, Baranov, Parkhomov, and myself. This is something that I talked about during Sochi, and Lou Pugnizio highlighted this work by Marakhtanov and Okunev. They showed also that there was transmutation in ballistically impacted bismuth alloy. They are saying, actually, that when a bullet containing bismuth collides with a steel target at a speed of up to 1 kilometer a second, the decay of 209 bismuth, the only isotope of bismuth that naturally occurs, goes to 198 platinum, which is stable, and 11 boron, which is stable. This is called a cluster decay. They also talk about other cluster decays that have been observed in different experiments over the years. And this is the lightest cluster decay you can possibly achieve, other than, of course, an alpha particle. So this is essentially a chunk of the bismuth that's flying off. So what we have here is Zetelepin and Baranov claiming that impacted bismuth can produce strange radiation and it can be reactivated. And you have this long set of studies by these two scientists that show that transmutation is occurring. The equipment that I'm proposing for these studies to include alpha, beta, gamma detectors. We have those in the EU. Dentafilm, these self-developing X-rays that were first used by the Lion author. These are relatively inexpensive. Web cameras and the cosmic ray finder, an approach that I developed when looking at the echo fuel in the summer of 2017. And we have those in the EU. We need a range of inexpensive radioactive samples like uranium, radium, and tritium. And Alan Goldwater has gone to the amazing trouble of selling some of his classic bikes and purchasing an SEM with EDS. And he has been commissioning that in his home lab. And so we have access to that in the US. So experiment one, I'm proposing impacted modified bismuth. So essentially it would be like after radiation testing, unmodified 308 rounds are to be shot into a target at 50 meters first. And then we'll look to see if there's any radiation from the samples there. Then bismuth alloy to be cast will be tested for alpha, beta, gamma and X-rays and strange radiation. So now the reason I've highlighted this bismuth alloy is that in the work of Marakhtanov and Okunev, they actually did not use straight bismuth. Bismuth is very brittle, and the material for most of the projectiles was eutectic bismuth alloy, 18% lead, 49.4% bismuth, 11.6% tin, and 21% indium by weight. So that's the alloy they were using. And in fact, I have found the exact alloy, I believe, that they were using. And here we go, 49 bismuth, 29 indium, 18 lead, and 12 tin. And it's commercially available, and it is $248 for around about a kilo. So we will cast that and put it into bullets. All the radioactive samples to be tested for activity with alpha, beta, gamma. Part of the bismuth alloy then used to cast the bullet tips. 10 ballistic impacts of bismuth alloy tip rounds into steel at 50 meters. The reason we got the 50 meters there is so that there is no sort of ricochet danger for the person doing the shooting. All impacted bismuth alloy tips tested for alpha, beta, gamma, X-rays and strange radiation. Radioactive samples exposed to some of the resulting impacted bismuth alloy. Control and impacted around debris to be tested on SEM and EDS. Okay, so also we will, at the time of just shortly following the bismuth alloy, we'll try and get the various pieces of equipment in there, like the dentafilm. We'll try and get the web camera in there to try and capture the peak point of activity to see if we can see any strange radiation. This would be quite interesting because we may be able to see some live emissions of strange radiation like straight afterwards. So I need to develop a more mobile solution for that. Anyway, so I went to the local gun club here and spoke with the principal there, and we decided to use these 308 Winchester rounds and to use this type. where you would have, this is lead, this is your jacket on the outside, and this is a plastic tip. We would take out the plastic tip and we would cast new tips and insert those out of the eutectic alloy. This particular round here can achieve 895 meters a second muzzle velocity. And so whilst this plastic tip replaced with the bismuth alloy will reduce the muzzle velocity slightly because the weight will increase, it should not be too slow compared to the required sort of up to 1,000 meters a second that is given in the papers. Other approaches we can do is to take the Lion Cu2O, which is now much older than 9 months, and take some of this crust and do a reheat on it and see if that increases its activity, or to take some of the echo fuel and reheat that and see if that can produce strange radiation and expose radioactive samples in a similar manner to the impacted bismuth experiment. However, I did speak to Suhas Ralkar earlier today, and he said that if we cannot reactivate the echo fuel, he would be willing to produce some more, and we can test it either immediately following production or shortly afterwards. So he has the equipment at a site, and he's willing to do that. So the most active material that I've witnessed in the last couple of years producing strange radiation and transmutation is the echo fuel. So this may be where we get the best results of the available tests being suggested. Experiment 3 would be to use water or residue from Shishkin cavitator. Here is his cavitator. Now, the echo fuel producing unit used 3 times 1.5 kilowatts ultrasonic horns cross-axis. This actually is a 4.5 kilowatt motor. So the actual input energy is the same in both cases. But the production of this device, this cavitator device, is really quite simple by comparison to the ultrasonic process. And you can feed water in and out of it continuously during the production. Now, what I would suggest maybe is to insert some silver powder, copper powder, or lead. Obviously, the less toxic versions are silver and copper. Copper being very ductile and being highly conductive, and silver being highly conductive, in my view, would be able to capture the strange radiation because Shoulder says it's kind of like a big electron. And my view is that it likes to live in metals, and the more conductive, the better. Aluminium powder might work, but it's quite likely to transmute. Lead is not likely to transmute because it's very heavy in terms of not transmute to get heavier, but maybe with the water in play, it might transmute to get lighter elements. But anyway, it's having some metal in there, and then you could potentially dry out the material. And so what you would do is you would either expose it to water that's been processed in the cavitator, or to water and a powder mix, or to just get the dry weight of metal and use that. And essentially that would be very similar to the echo fuel in that that actually was in a water body of light water and it was dried out. So the pre-assessed radioactive samples will be exposed to activated water or dry particulate residue so produced, possibly with parameter variation as temperature and electromagnetic exposure. Okay, so ignore the bit on the bottom. The passive test would be the bit where you're not varying parameters. In fact, parameters could be varied for any of the other tests, but initially we want to create some passive technologies. Experiment 4 would be to expose the radioactive samples to Hutchison LifeRay samples. Now, Hutchison is building a new lab where he currently is. In the interim, he's been housing his super huge version of the LifeRay generator, and you can see it here on the left. Now, why, do you ask, does it need to be so large? Because, well, he's using very long wavelengths, and so these can go into series or parallel, these beams. And we'll discuss the structure of this LifeRay in another presentation. He's already been able to demonstrate in 2012 with a smaller version of this apparent reduction in activity of uranium ore and also transmutation at the same time. These are some signatures of effectively strange radiation and Lena. And he's also had this example where he's had material that's been treated with non-treated radioactive nuclides or materials. And apparently the anecdote is that it did reduce the activity in those non-treated materials passively. From this work, there are, in my opinion, further potential benefits more than just trying to find a solution to Enewetak Atoll and Fukushima Daiichi. And that is that ballistic or cavitation methods making strange radiation-emitting materials could provide a simple way to produce samples to enable wide-scale investigation of this new type of penetrating radiation. If it is demonstrated that strange radiation can lower activity in radionuclides, it may prove that it is an active agent capable of producing low-energy nuclear reactions rather than merely a product. So there has been some suggestion, and I've even considered it myself, that, you know, as a result of the reaction, then these things get spat out and, you know, that is just a byproduct. Well, I think this is unlikely because if you look at the 11 years work of David Yurth replicating the studies of Kenneth Shoulders, he was actually producing these toroids and shooting them into radioactive materials, and the interaction between the two caused the removal of some of the level of the activity of the material that it impinged upon. So really, I'm very confident now that the strange radiation emitted has the opportunity to go on and do deactivation of radionuclides. And given that being the case, material produced by these methods could act as seed material in other low-energy nuclear reaction technology, including heat generation and element synthesis. So if these tested methods turn out to be reliable methods, both the ultrasonic, the hydrodynamic, and the ballistic methods, and the Hutchison LifeRay methods of producing strange radiation-emitting materials, this could allow these materials could be like salted into reactor materials for testing for heat generation and element synthesis without those individuals having all the complication of producing these materials and taking the risks which have been identified in our last presentation. So thank you very much for considering what we're putting forward here. Please do consider supporting this work. The links will be in the description of this video, but I've given them here also, and they'll be in the presentation, because whilst we do have good relationships with the individuals that have this technology, and we have got samples which we can work with, and in the case of the ballistics here, I'm coming up with a price with the gun club and with the people that can cast the metals. It will cost money. It does involve time, and if we do need to go to India, or we do need to go to America, or we do need to go to Russia, that will have expense involved also. So if you are interested, yes, there are issues with the environment. Yes, everyone would like cheaper energy. But for me, the situation with radionuclides and the fact that many more countries are considering getting nuclear energy, and that just compounds the potential risk of another nuclear disaster, semi-permanently or permanently, as far as civilization is concerned, contaminating another tract of the Earth. And will we get as lucky as we got with the last two accidents, which really, frankly, was not lucky? Can we risk it? I don't think we can. We do need to have something in place to deal with this that's actually practical. And in my opinion, it is a good use of my life to be exploring this phenomena. But we in the project and the people that have developed these technologies, they're not so young, you know. John has been doing this work since 1979, and you have Alexander Shishkin and Alexander Parkhomov and Zetelepin and Baranov. They're not fresh out of university. They've been doing nuclear science all of their life. And, you know, we have an opportunity here, but the window is shutting. So if you are serious, as I am, about the potential risk of these events and potential future events of this kind really causing problems for the biosphere, then really please consider supporting our work to enable these tests to happen. What I'd like to end with is that none of this insight, none of this potential solution and potential understanding of low-energy nuclear reactions could have even got off the ground if it wasn't for the many, many people that have already helped the project. The project would never have started if it wasn't for Francesco Celani. There are many, many people that have given their experience and their understanding to the project. Some scientists that are not even alive or with us right now, whose work feeds into what is being discussed in this presentation. There are people that have donated, sometimes quite significantly in terms of time, resources, and money, and other companies that have donated equipment. And many, many private donors have already got to us to this point. And I think really now we're starting to get into the home straight, and I would really love it for the community to come together and enable this technology to solve one of the most intractable problems that humanity and our biosphere faces. Thank you for your time, and I will see you in the near future.